So now that we have learned about standard cell potential, which is the E, and in previous chapters we learned about standard delta G and equilibrium constant K, we're going to start seeing how we can interconvert between each of those three items. We need to understand, number one, that electrical energy, this is energy produced by electricity, consists of the volts, which we know what that is, times the charge, okay? So coulombs is the charge of the electrons that are passing through that. So when a wire has electricity flowing through it, those electrons carry a charge. That charge is measured in coulombs, okay? You take that total coulombs times the voltage across the wire, and you will have the energy produced by those electrons flowing. Total charge can be determined by N, which is the number of electrons that are flowing in moles, okay, times F, which is Faraday's constant. Faraday's constant will be provided for you when you take our exams, but it is how much charge is carried by one mole of electrons. So it is this constant value. A charge of one electron is tiny, but if you have a whole mole of them, then it will carry a charge of 96,500. So one Faraday is 96,500 coulombs. That's the charge that one mole carries. Now you see the way I've written that coulombs per mole, and it also is joules per volt mole. The relationship between joules, okay, volts times coulombs, okay, that is the relationship here. So if we replaced the coulombs, what are we replacing it with? We are replacing it with joules over volts. So joules per volt mole would be another way to do that. And sometimes that's convenient when you're wanting certain units to cancel, is to call a coulomb this. But here is the relationship between the SI unit for energy, joule, and the volts and the coulombs for electrical energy. Okay, so with that in mind, we have a relationship between the free energy, delta G, the usable energy from the voltage and the number of electrons that are flowing through a cell. Now this equation, which you're going to have to commit to memory, can be either with or without standard state conditions, okay? We've talked about standard cell potential, but if a cell is not under standard state conditions, it will have a different cell potential. And so if you are working under standard state conditions, you have a relationship between standard delta G and standard cell potential. And if you're not running in standard state conditions, then you've got that top one there. Okay, so what does this equation tell us about the sign of E if a reaction is spontaneous? I need you to think back to what the sign of delta G is when a reaction is spontaneous. If delta G is less than zero, okay, and let's work with standard for now. If the standard delta G is less than zero, then under standard state conditions, this reaction is spontaneous in the forward direction. That is what a negative value tells me. So what would the sign be for E for it to be spontaneous in the forward direction? Well, when you look at the equation there, you see that minus sign in there. That tells me that the E must be greater than zero. So whenever you hook up one of these voltaic cells and you measure the voltage, it's going to run spontaneously and it will have a positive voltage read on our meter. And if we took this equation, we would then be able to figure out what the Gibbs free energy is for it. Okay, so I've already stated that. Okay, so we have this relationship. In a previous chapter on thermochemistry, we learned the relationship between K and standard delta G. So now we have ability to go between all three of these units using our other equation. So we just learned the left-hand side of this triangle, right? The relationship between Gibbs free energy and cell potential. And there is the equation for that. Now, I'm working under standard state conditions in this triangle because the relationship between K and delta G has to be related to the standard delta G, and that was the equation that we worked on before, okay? So that would be the chapter after we talked about thermodynamics and talked about that relationship. To get K, it must be the standard delta G. So we're working in the standard world here. Now, what about that bottom part of the triangle? You could start at the bottom left. To get to K, go up to the top and back down to K, and you've got two equations that I've asked you to commit to memory, and you can do that process. If you want to go across that bottom, you could simply derive that equation. Now, how would you do that? Well, those two equations that you have at the top there are both equal to standard delta G. So we can make the right-hand side equal to each other. So we would have minus N F standard E equal to minus R T natural log of K. Okay? So we could take this and then we could solve for E. So let's go ahead and do it. So E would be minus R T. I am dividing by minus N F. I've brought this over here, natural log of K. And those minuses would go away. A negative divided by a negative is a positive. So now we have a relationship between E and natural log of K. So what do we know? We now can just kind of summarize the connections of signs for each of these three things. To be spontaneous in the forward direction, we know that delta G would need to be negative. We know that E would have to be positive. And we would also know that K has got to be bigger than one. To be spontaneous in the forward direction, we need to head towards products, and K would be bigger than one, because products would be bigger than reactants, right? Products over reactants would be a greater than one value. So that is a spontaneous in the forward direction, as written. So when you look at a reaction, you're calculating the delta G for the reaction as written, and it would have a negative value. Now, if it's at equilibrium, then all of these values would equal what you see here. Standard delta G would be zero, the E of the cell would be zero, and the K would equal be one. That is standard values. Remember, standard state conditions means everything's at one, either atmosphere or molarity. So if everything is at one and it happens to be spontaneous, that would be a very, very odd situation. So there's probably no reaction out there ever that is happens to be right at equilibrium when everything's at one atmosphere or one molarity. But if it existed, that would be true. More likely, we'd have something where the delta G is greater than zero, and then that would give me a small k and a E that's negative, okay? So we're reversing these signs here, and that means that the reverse reaction is spontaneous, and that is what those signs mean. So we have already seen the first two columns of this. We're just adding our relationship with E to the mix. These should not be purely memorized statements. Might memorize one, and then the rest of them are related by the equations that you already know. Okay, so let's work a problem. If we went to a table of standard reduction potentials, we'd have to look up these reactions, but I've already provided them for you down there at the bottom. So using that table of two things, we're going to determine all three of those. So the two equations that would get us through that, if we have them, we can get between standard E, standard delta G, okay, standard E, standard delta G, and K. So with this information, we should be able to get the E first, right? So that's what we will, don't want to do that. I'll have us do the E first. So we look at our reaction. I'm going to go ahead and rewrite the reaction here so that I can point to things easily as we work the problem. We have the cobalt, and that's going to be aqueous. We have the nickel, it's a solid. We're going to cobalt, solid, and we have the nickel 2 plus, which is going to be aqueous. Okay? If we look at what cobalt is doing, we see it's going from cobalt 2 plus to cobalt solid. Look down there at the bottom. See, that's what we see there. So that is the reduction potential, and we would use that number as we see it. And I'll go ahead and write it over here. We have negative 0.28 volts. That's for the cobalt. And then when we follow the nickel along here, we see that the nickel starts as nickel solid. Well, that's the reverse of what I see down below, right? So I'm going to change the sign of that second one. It's going to be a positive 0.0, sorry, not zero. I don't know where I got that from. A positive 0.23 volts. So that's what we have here. Now, when you add those two things together, you're going to have a negative 0.05 volts. So what does that tell us about the spontaneity of this reaction as it's written? A negative voltage means it's spontaneous in the reverse direction. It's not going to go this direction spontaneously. But when you have a reaction, you calculate it for as it's written. Okay, so now we have the standard cell potential. The easiest thing for me to get from that would be the standard delta G with the equation minus N F standard E. Well, N is the number of electrons transferred. So when we look at our reaction, and it's really easy to see it when we're looking at the half reaction, cobalt going to cobalt solid had to lose two electrons. It gained two electrons to become that. And the nickel lost those same two electrons. So the N is 2. So 2 moles of electrons. Faraday's constant is 96,500 coulombs per mole of electrons. Okay? And the E we just determined, a negative 0.05 volts. Okay? So there is my values plugged in here. We have a negative, that's going to make it a positive, and the value is 9,650. Now what are the units? Coulombs times volts. Well, coulombs times volts is joule, and that is our energy unit that we would get out for that. So now we have the value for delta G. Once I have delta G, I can use this equation, and I'm going to come over here to write it. Delta G standard equals minus RT natural log of K. Okay, so now I can plug in the information I know over here. I have 9,650 joules. I have R, 8.314 joules per mole Kelvin. I have temperature. Temperature needs to be in Kelvin, and it's 25 degrees Celsius, so that's 298 Kelvin. Okay? And then the natural log of K. So the next thing that I'm going to want to do is I'm going to want to take everything to this side. So I'm going to take my 9,650 and divide by a negative 8.314 and divide by 298. That is going to give me a value of a negative 3.895. Okay? Put some lines here so we don't get confused. Okay, so what did I do to get that number? I took this, divided by a negative 8.314. The joules will cancel. The Kelvins have already canceled, okay? And we will end up with our value here, and that is equal to the natural log of K. Now, how do we get K from this? We take E to both sides, because E raised to the natural log is going to cancel those values. And that's going to give me the value of K. In this case, K is equal to 2.0 times 10 to the minus 2. Okay? So let's see if that makes sense. Would, if it is a negative E, that means it's spontaneous in this direction. That should give me a positive delta G, and it did. That also means it's spontaneous in the reverse direction. And if it's going to run in this direction to get to equilibrium, once it's there, the K value is going to be smaller than 1 because you're going to have more reactants than you had products. So all of those things fit together very nicely for us. So you are going to run across problems. In this one, you're just a straightforward. We're going to calculate between these three. But sometimes you're going to be presented with a problem, and they're not going to say, calculate all three. But you're going to know, I need E in order to finish this problem, but I have the information to get me K. Or, I need K to finish this problem, but they gave me cell potentials, so I want to start with getting the E. And you're going to have to utilize your two equations, okay? There's two of them right here. One, two. If you utilize those two equations, you can get between those three variables for any reaction that's a redox reaction. All right. All of this has to do with standard state conditions. We are running where solutions are one molar, and if they're gases, they have a pressure of one atmosphere. That's standard state condition. Well, you can imagine that there's a whole lot of reactions out there that are not under standard state conditions, so we're going to see how to handle that next.